Howdy again everyone, and today I'm checking out a brand new autofocus low budget full frame lens for Sony E-mount cameras from Chinese manufacturer Yongno. It's the YN85mm f1.8 SDF DSM. This lens has snuck its way onto the market with very little fanfare, although at only $200 it's potentially amazing value for money, and the rumours are that its image quality isn't bad. I was definitely very curious to take a look at it. I'd like to thank Yongno for sending me a copy of this lens for testing, although as usual this is a totally independent review. I'll be looking at both its strengths and weaknesses. An 85mm f1.8 lens is a very popular option among full-frame camera owners. Its short telephoto focal length manages to give you some real subject isolation for portrait photography, while still being nice and easy to use in all kinds of other situations, and that maximum aperture of f1.8 also enables you to shoot in pretty low light situations. It's very nice to see a low budget option arrive for Sony cameras that is also blessed with autofocus. In terms of its build quality, this is a surprisingly small and lightweight lens, especially for anyone who might have handled Sony's own FE85mm f1.8 option, or even a monstrous f1.4. It's really quite nice and compact, weighing 350 grams. There's a lot of plastic in the lens's construction, although it's top and tailed by a metal filter thread at the front and a metal lens mount at the back. There's no weather sealing around the lens mount, but the lens does have some useful controls. There is a USB connection on the side, which is securely covered by a tightly fitting rubber hood. That might get used in the future with firmware updates. You also get a focus mode switch and focus hold button next to the large rubberized focus ring. The ring makes a slight noise as you turn it, which feels a bit ropey and not very smooth, but as you might be able to see from this footage, it does respond to being turned fantastically well. What you can also see is some pretty strong focus breathing here, which will be bothersome for video makers. Now onto the autofocus. Take a look at this footage. It does focus quietly and at an average speed, but it doesn't really focus very confidently. It gets you there eventually, but sometimes takes you on a bit of a journey as it does so, and about 10% of the time it'll quite clearly miss, but take the picture anyway. So I wouldn't quite rely on it for your wedding photography or anything. The lens comes with a hood, it has a 58mm diameter filter thread, and it does not have image stabilization. Overall, you can certainly find a few places where Yongno had to cut costs with it. The lens actually feels solid enough, but the autofocus motor might require a little patience on the part of the photographer sometimes. Alright, let's move on and look at the lens's image quality, firstly on a full frame camera. It's quite a story really. Straight away at f1.8, we see brilliant sharpness and contrast in the middle of the image, although an edge of purple colour fringing is visible here too. Let's look over in the corners. Wow, I wasn't expecting this. The lens manages to remain very sharp there, capturing lots of detail. It's easily giving Sony's equivalent lens a run for its money there. Let's drop down to f2.8. We see a big increase in brightness and contrast there now, but also, unfortunately, a noticeable increase in colour fringing. Over in the middle, that purple fringing has now disappeared, leaving us with absolutely spectacular image quality. Stop down to f4, and the middle looks the same, but the corners, well actually the corners are deteriorating, looking softer, with some rather strong colour fringing now. At f5.6, f8, and f11, they get gradually worse. That chromatic aberration is really messing things up there. Well, that was very unusual. The lens's best image quality, if you want corner sharpness, is actually at f1.8, but it's not unheard of for chromatic aberrations to actually get worse as you stop certain lenses down, and I think the issue here is that those aberrations were enough to mess with the lens's sharpness in those corners as the colours began to stretch the image apart. So this really is a lens you'll want to use mostly at f1.8 or f2.8. Okay, well let's swap over to an APS-C camera now, my little 24MP Sony A5100. In the middle of your images at f1.8, we see some really excellent sharpness with a little touch of colour fringing. Over in the corners, the lens's resolution is still holding up surprisingly well, looking just a tiny bit softer. Stopping down to f2.8 yields fantastic sharpness in the corners, although a little chromatic aberration is creeping in there around contrasting edges. Back in the middle though, the lens reaches perfection. F4 looks just as good in the middle, and this time, on an APS-C camera at least, the corners are keeping it together. The corners continue to look excellent at f5.6 and f8, albeit with a little colour fringing in the mix. Stop down as far as f16 and the image becomes noticeably softer due to diffraction. So it's a better performance on APS-C than on full frame. I guess the very worst of the lens's issues with chromatic aberration were confined to those full frame edges. Well, let's move on and take a look at distortion and vignetting on a full frame camera. This is with in-camera corrections turned off. We can observe some fairly strong pincushion distortion here, and some rather strong vignetting at f1.8 too. Stop down to f2.8, f4, and even f5.6, and you can see that those corners are taking a long time to properly brighten up, so you will probably want to correct your images in critical situations. Now, let's see about close-up image quality. The lens can focus down to 80cm, so that's not too bad for getting pictures of smaller subjects. Close-up image quality is a bit of a problem though, being very soft at f1.8. f2.8 looks far better, and f4 is pretty sharp close-up, so whatever you do, don't shoot close-up at f1.8. Now, let's see how the lens performs against bright light. I'm pleased to say that it does quite well. Some flaring and mild glaring is visible, but it's less than average, which will contribute to the lens's quite good contrast levels. Now, let's take a look at the quality of this lens's bokeh. It's good news again, absolutely no problem here. Those out of focus backgrounds look lovely and soft without any serious issues at all. And finally, related to bokeh is longitudinal chromatic aberration. At f1.8, we see quite strong colour fringing on bokeh highlights around the plane of focus. But stop down to f2.8 and it goes away pretty quickly, and at f4, it's gone. Overall then, this Yongno lens was really interesting for me to test. Its build quality is good enough, although you'll have to be willing to tolerate the somewhat unreliable autofocus system, although admittedly, it does hit your target most of the time. When it comes to the lens's optics, there are a few crazy little things going on that you won't see on more expensive options out there, like the chromatic aberration when the aperture is topped down, the weak close-up image quality at f1.8, and the strong vignetting. But at the end of the day, the lens is a fantastic performer on APS-C cameras, and on full-frame cameras, it is capable of some pretty awesome sharpness if you keep your aperture as wide as f1.8 down to f2.8, and the quality of its bokeh is lovely, and its contrast is very good too. If you are willing to work within those limitations, it's actually pretty capable, and at only $200, certainly good value for money. And so for those reasons, for the price you have to pay, it has to come recommended.